Beer is one of the oldest beverages known to man. We have tabulations, written documents of brewing to the 4th century BC. If we think about where it came from, it was probably an accident. All we needed was a sugar and wild yeast, and the yeast could convert that sugar into alcohol, which of course early man found enjoyable. To make beer as a fermented process, we know that that goes back to 4000 BC, where we have written documents that actually explain the process. Now, the beer that the ancients knew was probably not the same beer that we drink today. It had similar components. Most often it was barley, water, and yeast. But originally there were lots of different spices that were used. It wasn't until around the 700s AD that we got into using hops in beer. This became the main definition of beer in 1516 with beer purity laws, which stated that beer should consist of malted barley, hops, yeast, and water. The malted barley gives us the sugar that is required to create ethanol. Plus, it gives us the amino acids and the lipids necessary for healthy yeast growth. The hops adds flavor components to balance the sugary taste of the malt, but it also adds some essential oils that extends the life of the beer. The yeast does the heavy lifting. It is there to convert sugar into ethanol. The ethanol is important because it's actually antibacterial, which means that beer will last longer in many cases than the grain might have. And water. Water is often overlooked, but it turns out that the water is essential to make sure that the yeast will process the carbohydrates well. This means that we have to have the right pH, and we have to have the right calcium and magnesium levels. Now, the process is not overly difficult, but there's a series of steps. Let's just look at it from the brewing standpoint, and then we'll talk about the chemistry of each of those steps. First, malting. We have to take the barley and turn it into malt. We're more or less getting it wet so it'll start to germinate. We don't want to germinate fully, so therefore we stop that by kilning. Kilning just means drying it out. So we're going to dry out our malted barley, and with this we can also add some other flavor components. We can heat it up a little bit to get a little caramelization, or we can really heat it up to get a nice bitter chocolate type taste components. Once we've kilned it, we're going to need to actually grind it, and then we can start the mashing process. The mashing process is going to add water so that we can start to hydrolyze our sugars, bringing the temperature up so that we can get the optimum temperature range so that we can get the starch hydrolysis enzymes, alpha amylase and beta amylase. Now at this point, we don't want to boil it. Turns out if we get too hot, we'll actually deactivate those two enzymes, giving the beer a very sweet flavor. So we leave it there for a while and let those two enzymes really convert much of the starches into our small fermentationable sugars. At that point, now we've converted most of those, we need to remove the wort, which is going to be our dissolved components, away from our grain, our husks. Then we're going to take that wort and bring it up to a boil. When we bring that wort up to a boil, we're doing a couple of things. First of all, we're making sure that we're sterilizing the entire wort. This is important because when we introduce our yeast, we want to make sure it's the yeast we want and not a wild yeast or any other bacteria. We also, at this point, will introduce hops. There's several places where it can introduce hops, but at the boil, what we'll be doing is extracting out of the hops the alpha and beta acids that we need to add flavor components, plus some other essential oils that'll help stabilize the beer. We then filter out the hops and we bring that down to a lower temperature so that we can have the yeast work on the process. Now, what is the yeast doing? The yeast is converting the sugars into ethanol. This is an important role. We don't have beer unless we have the ethanol. Now, the process starts out as aerobic respiration and is going to go to anaerobic respiration. It's this anaerobic respiration that gets us to the ethanol that is often associated with beer. Once the fermentation is done, we have something that really resembles beer. But we're going to let that age, sometimes just a few days, in other cases, maybe months, so that we can get different components of taste to either develop or to be inhibited. At that point, we need to do a second fermentation because, as we know, beer is carbonated. The second fermentation is focused less on creation of ethanol and more the creation of carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide carbonates the beer and gives us the mouthfeel that we're used to. If we think about it historically, it turns out the ethanol and the carbon dioxide were important for this to stay stable. The lack of oxygen and the ethanol were both very important in making beer last longer. Then we can package it, either bottles, cans, or kegs. This is the overall beer process. We're taking a grain, letting it start its germination, stopping it so that we can use enzymes to convert carbohydrates into simple sugars. Those simple sugars are then converted into ethanol, and then we finish that out by allowing the fermentation with the yeast to not only create ethanol, but also create carbon dioxide. This is what we know of as beer.